Radio.
Badass Women's Hour XL on Talk Radio.
She'll get you talking.
Welcome back to Badass Women's Hour with me, Harriet Minter, and my co-host Natalie Campbell and Emma Sexton here on Talk Radio. We have been talking endometriosis earlier in the show today. Just heard the amazing Jane there telling us her story. She called in with it. It's just, still talking about it now. Do give us a call, 0344 499 1000, because we'd love to hear your stories and your experiences as well. We need to talk about this more clearly until people start listening.
Yeah, definitely.
But as we like to bring in, at this point in the show, a really fabulous guest. Somebody inspirational, amazing, changing the world, disrupting the status quo. And I think we might have found the most disruptive of the disruptors tonight. I'm very excited. We have the fantastic Emma Sayle, founder of Killing Kittens, with us. Thank you for joining us.
Thanks for having me.
Oh, so we're going to talk about what Killing Kittens is, but I think the best way we can talk about that is to ask, where did the name come from, Emma?
A very drunken Ibethan wedding where none of us had slept for about 3 days. And one of the guests who couldn't make the wedding actually phoned in the next morning and said, are you guys just all sat around killing kittens at the moment? And so we had this discussion about what she meant. It was like, well, don't you know? And I went, I have no idea what that means. And it's like, there's a cyber slang expression for every time you masturbate, God kills a kitten. So she was basically saying, are you just guys, is everyone just sat around
having
wanking?
A nice time.
Yeah, exactly. And sorry, I thought that's a cool name.
Sorry for the slightly sweary tone there, but you know what, man. So Killing Kittens, what is it? Tell us what it is, what it's actually about.
It's in its 13th year now, and it started basically the same time as sort of Sex and the City come out and Summer's hit the high street, and there was this whole kind of female sexual thing going on, and I just felt that everything in the adult world and all the parties and anything to do with sex was very male focused, and they were very much the ones leading the charge, even though people were talking about everything being female friendly and girls had a right to talk about orgasms and dildos and everything. And so sort of there was no massive business plan, just a right, this is not balance and I want to do something about it, so let's start by doing little parties where they're kind of where sex goes on, but women are very much in control, and we have the rules where guys aren't allowed to approach girls they don't know, they have to wait for the girls to make the first move. So it's sort of from day one it's been very much about women being in control of their sexuality and controlling what they do and feeling empowered. And it's been a big sort of online community as well that's kind of grown. And that's sort of the ethos behind it.
Cool. Nat, you've got a question. Emma, just talk into the mic a little bit more so we can be totally clear. Don't want to miss a word of this. Nat.
What I was just going to say, it obviously works, because how I found out about it was that I was minding my own business one day and Emma and Harriet started talking. We were talking about sex, and then they threw in the name of a club, Killing Kittens. And I was like, what is this thing that you speak of? And they told me
That's
all about
disgusting.
It. And I was like, this is fabulous. Why do I not know anything about it? Along with another word that I can't use. I can say BDSM.
I don't know, but we'll just gloss on over it.
It's a technical term. So we're talking about that, and I from that point onwards, you've been a friend of the show. why do you think more women are talking about sex, talking about their own pleasure, and getting into it in a way that is on their own terms?
I think I've seen a massive, it's been over a decade of doing it, a massive shift. I think society has become a lot more open. And at the same time, women have become a lot more free and financially independent. And I think when you get within your life, you can make your own decisions. So, more people splitting up, getting divorced, quite happy being single. There isn't that kind of, you have to find a man or partner in your 20s, get married, have kids, anymore. That's sort of, if you want to work, if you want to have kids, if you want to be a stay-at-home mom, it's sort of, as a woman, you have all these choices. And at the same time, that's gonna fall into the whole sexuality side. So it's not a case of, right, you're straight or you're a lesbian anymore. It's kind of, if you're single, there's this kind of sort of fluid, more fluid movement. And girls naturally, biologically, are in this scale. There's this Kinsey scale, sexual scale of 1 to 7, and men tend to be 1 or 7, and women biologically fall in the middle, 3, 4, 5. So there's kind of, it's why we're much more touchy-feely and, oh, she looks hot. And, you know, I probably check out girls walking up the street more than my husband does. He might fight me on that one. But, and it's just the way we're made. So there, it then goes into the whole sexual side of girls now, you know, especially the millennials, my God, they scare me. They go out and one night they go out and decide they fancy a guy, and the next night they go out and decide to sleep with two girls. It's sort of, and there's no label. So I think there used to be really strong labels on sexuality, and now it's kind of, fluidity. It's sort of, yeah, there's, that's all open. The word to it, because you can't even label what it's become.
Yeah, brilliant. Emma, I want to, I love how this show's got loads of Emmas on it. So I wanted, like, get you to go back to, like, that first event. Like, the three of us have done lots of events. The three of us have started initiatives, right? It's quite,
I mean, I think we just have to clarify, like, quite boring panel events. Like,
what? No, just like, but, you know, for you to, like, set up and launch something, you know, a sex party like this, going back to that first one, and you've been in business now 13 years, like, what, like, was that nerve-wracking? Have you learned a lot since that first event?
Yeah, I mean, the first event, to be honest, wasn't actually much different to some of the events. We do a couple of monthly ones now that are very much the old school mainstream KK sort of setup. And the first event I did had about 40, 50 people.
But did you not have that pre-party nerve?
Yeah, exactly.
What if no one does?
I'd pre-sold the tickets though, so for £100 a pop, they were going to turn up. there was slightly on the nerve front, but at the same time, I've always been this sort of stubborn, pig-headed. I'm Aries. I'm kind of the head. It goes down. It will work, and there's no such thing as failure, and can't. It's sort of. Right, so they're doing it.
And now you've got lots of different divisions, because didn't you, I don't know if you've still got it, but you had one for like over a certain age. Do you have like your silver kitten?
Mum's idea. Yeah. She said you should launch Saga Kittens. Saga Kittens isn't, yeah, it's not really a sexy name. How about Silver? So we still have the Silver Kitten set up, but also we do, because we do so many events, we'd sort of have about 20 going on in the UK each month. Some of the events, like our monthly cabaret night, we do, actually there's no age gap. On it, and our big country parties, there's no age. So there's sort of, whereas before it was a monthly party where the age range was up until 45, it's sort of, there's a couple of events every month now that actually we don't need a Silver Kittens.
Do you have to have sex?
No.
We are going to answer more questions in a minute because we need to go to a little break. But we would like, if you've got questions for Emma about Killing Kittens and exactly what goes on, we're going to be asking some of them. But do tweet us at Badass Women's Hour HR or at Talk Radio. And we are going to be here with Emma Sayle from Killing Kittens after this break.
Across the UK, online and on DAB. Badass Women's Hour XL on Talk Radio.
Welcome back to Badass Women's Hour XL here on Talk Radio. I'm Harriet Minter here with my co-hosts Emma Sexton and Natalie Campbell. And we also have the incredible Emma Sayle, founder of Killing Kittens, in the studio with us. So, Emma, before we went to break, Matt asked, do you have to have sex? You said no, which leads me to ask, what goes on at these parties? Do you turn up, have a little drink, do some mingling? Does everyone throw their car keys in a bowl? What happens?
No, in answer to your question, you don't have to have sex. And actually, we have over half the events we do now don't involve full sex. So we have different talks and different workshops and couples weekends and club nights and sort of drinks events that actually is keep your clothes on and more of a kind of meet other people or learn about yourself in the talks and things. And like, we have some talks just for single guys, some for single men. But at the sort of the main old school KK events, you'd turn up, you'd walk into a private residence, and it'd be like walking into a private party and everyone's masked. And we have fizz and oyster reception, and you kind of all stand around going, oh, this is a nice looking bunch of people. And the tension's in the air, though, because everyone knows what's meant to happen. And then, to be honest, if you stay around the bar area or we have DJs, and if you stay in that bit, then you don't really, you don't see anything. It's only if you sort of then wander off into the playrooms or the bedrooms mm-hmm. that you'd then Dante's Inferno would sort of hit you in the face of like writhing limbs.
And good
times. Yeah, and that's the thing. It's sort of after a few hours, the if you're by the bar, you'll think, well, this was busy, and now it's sort of half the people are here, and people
where
are just
have
sort
they
of
gone?
Well, what could they be doing? But you know, it's kind of, you get sort of 50% of the people that come to the events will keep their clothes on, and they just like the atmosphere, and couples who just want to do something naughty together and just attend, and groups of girls who come down because they can dance around in their lingerie and not get set upon by guys out on the pool. So there's sort of, there's lots of different reasons.
There's power to that though.
Yeah.
I think because, so ultimately, if you're going to a Killing Kittens party, you know what you're, you know what the environment is, you know what the potential is, you know what the intent is. So you kind of lose your inhibition. So I can imagine the tension at the beginning of the night, but that ability to just say, actually, I do want to dance in my lingerie, and a guy is not going to talk to me because that's the rules, and having those boundaries in place, I can imagine how powerful that feels. We were laughing in the break. I'm not sure about the yoga bit, the naked yoga. Not there. I'm not quite
there
yet.
No, downward dog in your face.
No. No. But the parties, I can already get a sense of how, I prefer the word powerful as opposed to empowering, but I can imagine.
It is. It's very difficult to describe it because the minute you say there's sex going on, people will instantly go, that's disgusting, it's seedy, it matter. And I always say it's really hard to describe it. It's actually a really unseedy atmosphere. Mm-hmm. It's less seedy than going into busy pubs and bars and clubs in London where you just get hit on. Well, I used to. You get hit on left, right and centre, and you can't. It's running the gauntlet
because
to go and have
no
a pee.
Rules. There's because, no, yeah.
And you're not relaxed, whereas, you know, the girls always say that come to ours, actually, because it's up to them and they're in control and they can just walk around in their knickers and heels and feel completely comfortable. So there's lots of different reasons people come. And actually, that's a massive one that comes out of what the feedback we get of girls that come along, to say they just felt like totally empowered and that they just owned themselves and could do what they wanted to do. And when you can do what you want to do, a lot of the time you don't do anything. Yeah.
So how have you seen kind of sex and relationships and how we interact change in the 13 years? Particularly, you know, when I was dating 13 years ago, you met somebody in a bar, it was face to face, you had to hope that they didn't lose the number that you scrawled on a piece of paper and shoved at them, you know, something like that. And now everything is online, you know, you're having text sex with somebody before you've even known their second name. It's all digital. How has that changed kind of Killing Kittens and how you guys work and what you've seen happen?
Well, to be honest, we've sort of grown as that's all happened. We've had this whole online community going on, and our site, we're having a whole new site and app built at the moment, but the site's always been the online community, like dating site, and so you put in your details and you can search and browse and hook up with other members. And actually, over 80% of our members, we've got 100,000 members online. Wow. And over 80% of them are actually singles, pretty much 50-50 girls and guys, which people wouldn't know because they just see the Daily Mail tabloid headlines of sex parties and assume that's what KK is and it's all couples. So we've kind of had a big element of, as dating's changed, actually we've had the world going on at the same time, and a lot of people finding each other, that other halves, you know, through the site and not coming to any events.
When does the app launch? Just out of interest.
Later this year.
Okay, thanks very much. Downloads.
That's
timer.
A great story. So how did you two meet?
Yeah,
so
I've got some friends who've done that.
Emma, where do you want to take it next? You know, you're kind of building a global empire. Didn't you open up in Venice the other week?
Yeah, last weekend we were in Venice.
Yeah.
So we've got lots of European cities, and then we've got LA and New York going on regularly in the States, and then Perth, Melbourne and Sydney in Australia. So they're going great. And actually, you know, it'd be great to take some of our other events, like the talks and things, different monthly nights over there. But to be honest, the big thing is our whole online thing, because if you're global, then it's, you know, we call it the mothership. And actually, it's just one site sort of focusing on the entire world, and where anyone in the world can sign up to be a member is sort of where we're pushing it.
Are there cultural differences at your parties in different parts of the world?
Not really. When it comes to sex, it's quite, you know, sex hasn't changed. You can throw all this digital stuff and sex robots and all the tech side, but at the end of the day, we are animals, and sex hasn't changed. I haven't seen new positions pop up in the last decade. There it is. It's missionary. It's vanilla. Oh, look, he's going down on her. She's making the same noises as she did 10 years ago. There's no keywords thrown in. And it's never going to change. So
How did you grow Killing Kittens? Like, did it start off where you threw your first party and it was just all of your mates, or does it? How did you grow up? You were like, this is going to be strange when we go for coffee next week.
Yeah. All my family, cousins. I need you there. To be honest, it was word of mouth to start with, and I had a social group of friends who were very hedonistic and what I saw going on and that was the wedding in Ibiza as well. Yeah. And they were all at it with everyone left, right and center. So there was an element of some of that, but also kind of media right off the bat was a sort of tabloid outrage, which got new members in. Mm-hmm. So it's been very much word of mouth. I mean, we've never paid for any advertising or marketing. Wow. On that front at all. It's the most, you know, badly kept secret, I would say.
But that shows that people are having a good experience, because you don't get to 100,000 members if people don't go and feel like they're having a good time, they're having an experience that they want to repeat, and they're having an experience that they want to tell other people about.
Yeah, hopefully.
Yeah. 100,000 does not lie.
No.
And do you notice, do you have a selection criteria for, can anyone rock up? What's the kind of policy, in and out policy?
We've got a vetting procedure. So everyone that comes, it's mainly security. So people that come to the events have to register on our site to start with and submit basic details. And now we've upped it even more. They have to hold up a piece of paper with the day, today's date to show that they're a real human being. Mm-hmm. So it's that, but you know, I often, you know, sort of get lynched and go, oh, you only let good looking people in. And it's not the case at all. It's just, you look at photos and go, they're just nice looking people that, you know, other members are going to want to see at parties. It's not some thug looking guy who looks like he's, you know, mm-hmm. going to rape every female out there and is all gimped up mask, and you know, that's all it is. It's just sort of, well, what they write as well, you know, if someone writes in their bio that they hate women and they want all women to die, yeah, then we're not going to accept their registration. Mm-hmm. And if people put in penis shots as their headshots, which generally happens daily, then they won't get accepted. Yeah, it's just that, that's the criteria. It's just, we look for just nice normal looking people, and that's it, really.
And when you work in sex all day, every day, does it get boring? Because we're having a lovely time chatting about it. We want to chat about it with our girlfriends. But when it's work, when it's got kind of financials attached to it and spreadsheets and, you know, marketing policies and all this jazz, do you get to the point where you're like, oh, God, don't talk to me about missionary position again. I can't deal with it.
Do you know what? It doesn't get boring because Every day is hilarious and we have such a giggle and the incoming emails we'll often get, and every party something will go on, like a guy turning up the other week with a suitcase full of clothes pegs, and him and his missus just came out of the bathroom naked just with clothes pegs. And that, that's a first.
If it works for you.
Exactly. So yeah, it's just, you know what I mean? It's ongoing. It's just ongoing amusement. And the members are great because the minute you're seeing people naked and they're talking about sex, the guards go down, the egos, you lose the egos. We get, you know, great emails from girls every day and the reasons they come. And it's been really, we've had this blog launch last summer with lots of reviews from girls. And that's been really interesting because I've never really, you know, had a huge interaction to know why girls come, and people, girls have been raped and they get their power back by coming, and or religious backgrounds. So, yeah.
And Emma, thank you so much for coming in. We're sort of running out of time, but if anyone wants to find out about it quickly, where can they find out more?
Our website, www.killingkittens.com.
Very, very straightforward. Easy. Yeah.
Or just Google Killing Kittens. There isn't anyone else out there.
It's not a name you're going to forget, is it?
Exactly.
Emma Sayle, from founder of Killing Kittens, you've been fantastic. Thank you so much for joining us
tonight
on Badass Women's Hour. We're definitely going to be chatting about some of the stuff that has come up there after the news here on Talk Radio.